Sunday morning, end of the first week of March. I think it's the 8th. The Moananuanu estuary looking absolutely stunning, how it should do every day. Just had 3 days of really good fun surf. The water down the Otahu estuary, you could actually see the bottom. Watched the kids jumping off the wharf. Ooh, the water there was a little bit of extra green and different strange sand formations off the point. But generally speaking, not too bad. So we'll see what's going to be happening over the next week and over leading up to Beachhop and Easter. So we're down on the Moananuanu estuary and the tide has just turned to be coming in, and this is what we're recording. And remember, we were here yesterday and this part of the estuary was very tidy. So I've been away for 6 weeks and nothing's really changed. Very tidy on Friday, Saturday and Sunday. Come Monday morning, this is what we get. Explosion of algae because of excess nitrogen put into our estuary, and we've had no rain. And so the only thing that's bringing moisture into the estuary is the effluent from the wastewater plant. And this is our wildlife. And we've got to remember, just last week, the Thames Coromandel District Council to resolve not to endorse Policy 13 of the New Zealand Coastal Policy Statement and cancelled its submissions and everyone else's submissions on natural character to go into the 10-year plan. And here we are, poisoning our wildlife. If this estuary ain't natural character, what is? And these inhabitants of these areas of natural character, Mark was the Waikato Regional Council officer that was omitting data on wastewater flows and volumes at the turn of the century. So it's a sad state of affairs. We'll come back in a couple of hours and we'll see what's happening. But it ain't looking good at the moment. Yeah, you wonder how much cyanobacteria is floating around. No wonder the health department's got up their signs. And this is why the councils aren't taking any water testing, because they don't want anyone to know exactly about the deoxification of our estuaries. So I've popped back an hour and a half to see what the accumulation has been, and there you have it. As I said earlier, clear of this muck over the weekend. All the tourists go home. And we, the residents, are left to swim in this. And Viola water and Opus are making a profit. Well, we pay doctor's fees. And that was a kind of a long distance shot. This is a close up at my feet. This is only a small dump. Some days it's horrendous. And don't forget, this is the most popular beach in New Zealand. And you got to remember, and I keep saying it, that Opus is solely owned by the Malaysian government. So our rates are struck in Kuala Lumpur. Now, would you eat whitebait out of here? So I've just changed location. I was looking south just before. Now we're looking north. And there's just a pulse of this. So as per usual, stretching for over k's. I'm going to zoom out and see if you can get a greater perspective. So that's the view I took yesterday at the same tide. And it was clear of this eutrophication. So, ratepayers paying to poison their own environment. They're not knowing they're doing so. Covered up by the Thames Coromandel bureaucracy. Covered up by the local politicians. And a blind eye turned by Waikato Regional Council, the Department of Conservation, and the Ministry of Health. And as I said earlier on, the politicians of the Thames Coromandel District Council resolved last week not to have, accept, or listen to any submissions on natural character as prescribed under the 2010 National Coastal Policy Statement. And you can see this is the reason why they don't want to have that discussion. Poisoning for profit. And we can see amongst that rubbish we've seen, we can see films of blue algae. Very hard to catch in this light. And of course, obviously, the obvious sign of excess nutrients in the water. excessive plant growth. Aquatic plant growth, I should say. So even if you're not walking in the water, the fine aerosols you can inhale. And then blame your illness on a chicken sandwich or a pork pie. But really it's the porkies told by the subcontractors of the council and the councils themselves. Yeah, I'm looking at the stormwater pipe. And you can just see the blue algae. And show you how high we are up to the tributary. And I'll just come back. Now we haven't had any rain. And yet when you look up the stormwater pipe, that's got blue algae all around it. You can just see how damp it is. And it's damp right up the pipe. So the tide wouldn't have come in here. So something's come out of here quite recently, because it's like this is really, really damp. And there's blue algae everywhere. So something's been discharged out of here under pressure. And there's been no rain. No rain, stormwater pipe oozing, blue algae. Makes you wonder. Because of the film on top of the water, we can see the reflection of the kotuku.
We're looking up the estuary, and you can see this is all the stuff that we watch every morning on the south side of the wastewater plant. Here it is leaving on the tide. There's the wastewater plant. See, it's running along the edge. This is a state highway. And here's all that shit. And we'll swing around and we'll watch it going out past the boat park. Here we are watching it come on the other side of the bridge. All this pus. And then we'll see. We'll have to pan back in again. Life will be hard here. Look at all. He's heading out. Look at it all over here. It's all over the estuary. Heading toward the bar that's protected under the National Coastal Policy Statement against any of this sort of stuff. And it goes right past the marina entrance and down the man-created channel. You can see it right on the other side of the marina entrance there, heading to the bar. Just scanned out to stop the vibration because I can't be bothered getting my tripod. But you can see the shit's everywhere now in the outer harbour. And if you look right up under that tree there, I'm coming in, that's the stuff that's coming down from the Waikiki stream. That's not coming from the Moananuanu. That's coming down from the main stream from the spray field. So fields. And I'll bring back right down to underneath the bridge again, where people are walking every day. And so this was discharged in the dark. That's coming out in the light. And we've got to bring this to light because no one is listening.
So there it is, the Whangamata wastewater plant, sequential batch reactors, which is 6,000 cubic meters of volume, and on a day like today they can handle that volume, but what we're seeing in the river, there's something amiss with the management. But in the Harrison Grierson report, the Whitianga, Tauru Pau Nui and the Whangamata wastewater plant, it's highlighted that the quality of the effluent is based on the capacity of the sequential batch reactors to cope with the inflow. So Whangamata is twice as big as the others because the people got involved in the consent process, and that doesn't cope, and we'll see that next week with Beachhop, where the maximum total population according to the council is 26,000, which is peak at Christmas time, but some strange reason.
Now, we've talked about it being the biggest event of its kind in the Southern Hemisphere. How big has this event got? Well, we opened up entry on the 1st of October for this event, and we sold out in 24 hours. That's 1,000 cars entered in one day, and you know, I go to car events all over the world, and that's pretty tough to beat. Also, we've got a way of measuring how many people are here. It's not a particular event. The council have a sewage treatment plant, and they weigh measure all the wastewater. And they estimated 110,000 people here last year on the Saturday.
Mega event. On that note, I'm going to move on, and I am actually move on in the show, by the way. But I'll leave you back to putting the cars in their place.